Hello and a very good morning to you. It's Wednesday the 11th of January 2017. Welcome to another live late night chat show, boys and girls. This is the latest we've done for a while and it's just coming up to, what time are we recording tonight? 25 past 12 in the morning, so it's Wednesday morning. Let's say very, very important news. First up today, news about Katie the cat. Oh yes, I know you're waiting to hear the news of Katie the cat. As you can see, I'm not looking sad, so it must be good news. Oh, yes. Let's just say hello to the early birds in tonight. Hello to Wendy, who's with us this morning. Jerry's there. Danny Davis. Paul Dow is calling us insomniacs. Of course it. Or is it insomaniacs? I'm never quite sure. Insomniacs. Or insomaniacs. Does it matter? Does it depend where you're coming from? We are all insomniacs. Yes, in fact, who else was it said something like that? Where are you now? There was someone else who mentioned. Oh, yes, there he is. Damo says, so you don't sleep? Never. Come on, Damo. We're a long time dead, dear. We haven't got time to sleep. I've got so much to say. I can't afford to die yet, dear. It's too much to say. I haven't finished talking yet. I've got at least 500 years worth of talking to do. Whether or not you want to listen is entirely up to you, my darlings. Okay, we need to keep talking. Thank you, Damo. And Antonio says he was going to sleep. Oh, don't go to sleep yet, Antonio. As I said, you're a long time dead, dear. You know, so don't sleep now. Save it. You'll have plenty of time to sleep when you're dead. Okay, so don't do it now, please. Don't be rude and go to sleep. Not while I'm chatting away. Hello to Elaine. Elaine's with us in Israel. Hello, Elaine. All right, darling. It's 2 a.m. in Elaine. She's even later than us. It's only 12:30 here. She's up at 2:30 in the morning, you see. That's what I call a dedicated viewer. Dedicated viewer, that's it. Or maybe you're just a listener. Maybe you got your little... Because this show, Elaine, I have to tell you, is very good at assisting people, not assisting suicides. Oh, mind you. Actually, I think if you've got anyone who wants to be assisted suicide to die, as you know, totally illegal in most countries to help someone to die. So if you was to lock someone in a room and play these shows to them non-stop, you could be thrown in prison for assisting someone's suicide. You really could. Well, my mate would say that anyway. No support from him at all. He thinks all this is a bit of a joke, dear. I know. My mate, you would think that they would support you, wouldn't you? Friends and people like that. But no, no, no. Do you know what he calls this? He doesn't call this a worldwide television spectacular. He calls me, are you ready for this? And I quote, piddly little YouTuber. Piddly little YouTuber. Apparently, I'm a piddly little YouTuber. I said you won't be saying that one day. One day, my friend, you'll get a couple of tickets in the post to the BBC Television Centre to come and watch my chat. So when they eventually ring up and take me on there. Nope, no messages. I think they must be dialing the wrong number, I reckon. Hello today to Zach Thompson. Hello, Zach. Excuse me. Is that it? Is that all we've got today? Oh, Lou's with us. Love the intro music. I'm glad you like that. Intro music reminds me of watching a $6 million man. Would you like it again? Which one do you mean? Do you mean the 30-second countdown? Or do you mean the intro with the Union Jack and all that business going on? Which I'm not quite sure which one you mean. Nice to meet you last night, Lou. Lou turned up at the karaoke last night. A little bit too late to sing, but he sat there and took in the atmosphere. I'm not sure if... you might have got there after the cheap drinks finished, because they finished at 11 o'clock. Didn't they? Yes. Hello, Lou. I think that's it. Still coughing. Oh, no. No, that's not a bad cough, actually, Elaine. It's nothing like what it was, believe me. All I'm doing, sometimes a little bit of stuff comes up and you've got to cough to remove it. Otherwise, I sound all bubbly. You know, I'll sound like I'm talking from under the sea. Under the sea. Do you think mermaids really exist? Perhaps I was a I could be a merman, couldn't I? Jerry's enjoying the blue today. Yes, I've come as a deck chair today, Jerry. As you can see, this is one of my favourite shirts and one that hasn't yet gone tight round the stomach. like so many of the others, unfortunately. Thank you. Oh, the longer 2 minute one. Yes, I'm not sure where that's from, to be honest. You mean the 3 minute one? Da, 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 da. You mean that one, don't you? A nice piece of music, that, yes. Good. So let me tell you about Katie the cat. Okay, Katie the cat. So today, as you well know, boys and girls, I took Katie the cat into the vet. She's been very different. It's just been going on for some time, to be honest. She walks around in circles a lot of the time. Following us. I don't think she's following her. She just walks around in circles all the time. She howls, not meows. She howls when she can't hear, when she can't see me. It's not like a meow. It's not like a meow. It's like a... And it's quite loud. But it doesn't go on for long. You know, she'll do it for a while, realise I'm not coming, and then she shuts up. She spends an awful lot of time staring at the wall and staring into space. She makes a mess of the kitchen. No, that's wrong. She messes on the kitchen floor. She messes on the kitchen floor a little bit. A couple of times a day, so I have to keep washing that. Food-wise, she eats. But I was concerned. But it's the noise. I don't know if she's in pain or not. So went to the vet today, and there's a particular vet that I like. I go to a place called Canucci Vets, which is here in Bracknell, where this purpose built, where this United Kingdom Talk television complex is, boys and girls. Oh yes, I know what you're saying. I can hear you saying it now. Are there guided tours? I'm afraid not. This place is so big it would take you a week to get round it. It really would. This is massive. Massive. I mean, all the studios are kitted out roughly the same. You know, they all look very... So now and again, you might see something different. You're like, oh, he's in a different studio today. But generally, you know, there's a clock in every one of them and all that business. And copies. These are actually the original ones, okay? My original 40th anniversary Mandy disc, as given to me by the lovely Eloise, who won it. Yes. And arranged by Anne and Rachel as well. Wonderful. That's there. We have the Chris Reardon Star of Fame. Okay. We have the Barrowman. All these things are duplicated in other studios, boys and girls. But occasionally you see something different on there. And when you see that, you think, he's in one of his other studios. But I'm afraid, no, we don't do guided tours. Now and again, we have a little person up here for an interview. Ray Reynolds has been here in this studio. Nikki French has been here in this studio. Who's Nikki French, you're wondering? Oh, you must know, dear. She only represented the Eurovision Song Contest for the UK 1 year. Look it up if you don't believe me. Nikki French was here in this studio. The place is full of celebrities most of the time, dear. Full of celebrities. No, that's incorrect. The place is full of stars most of the time. We don't do celebrities, dear. I've told you before, I've no interest in celebrities. Anyway, back to the story. So, took her in, and I particularly like this vet because she is very, very compassionate with the animals. Now, I'm not saying that you need to be compassionate to be a good vet. When I was in hospital, and it's been a while now, it's been, oh my gosh, it must be 20 years now, when I had that burst appendix, was it? No, it's about 16 or 17 years since I had that burst appendix. And, I got itchy nose suddenly. Oh, no tissues. Oh, dear. It's here I get itchy nose there. Is that all right now? That's better. Do you know what people do? When I'm DJing and I start doing all, they say, oh, you're taking the drugs again. I don't think so. I have never, ever done that. Oh, no. How can you have stuff shoved up your nose? And it's bad enough taking a pill. I mean, I could go as far as taking a pill. Well, I won't lie to you. I did in the 90s. I went as far as going to raves and doing little pills. I did, dear. Oh, I was dancing all night long, dear. Dancing all night. But that's as far as I went. I never did anything else. I certainly never shoved anything up my nose. So please don't think I'm sitting here doing that, you know. Oh, disgusting, dear. Anyway, yes. So there was a surgeon in the hospital that I was. And he wasn't horrible or anything like that. Don't get me wrong here. But he was... efficient. Shall we say efficient? So he would come along and say, yeah. Ah, no, well, no, there's something still to come out of that, I can tell. I'm going to make a little incision there, OK? You shouldn't feel anything, and I'll put a pipe in there, all right? And that was it. You know, he just told you how it was. Now, I don't mean that someone like that is any worse than someone who's compassionate, but there's a bit of a difference, isn't there? You know what I mean. And she is very, very compassionate. So the cat came in, and actually, I opened the door of the little cat basket while I was waiting to go in, you see. I'd open this door, and sometimes she's quite happily, but then she tried to get out. So I said, oh, I'm sorry. She said, that's okay, if you can bring her in like that. So I had her in my arms and I put her down. And I explained to her what it was, and she needed her nails looking out as well. Because when cats stop going outside, their nails stop growing. Did you know that? Oh, yes. Sorry, the nails start growing more because they're not like pulling them off on trees and ruining fences and that sort. I'm sure she single-handedly tore my fence down once while she was out there. Meow, meow, like that. Thank you, £800 for a new one. Oh, well. So they do keep growing, and you have to have them cut. And I knew that it was time. Now, I've got a stone floor in the kitchen. It's like a slate floor, not flat. So it's like, you know, slates on roofs, like grey, and it's all like okay, it's rough, not rough so that you would cut yourself, but it's rough, it's not smooth, which incidentally makes it harder to clean when she messes, but that's one of those things. And so when I know it's time for her claws to be cut, you can hear her walking around like that, right? Like click clop, like a horse. Oh, that's actually, I'd be better to do it a bit like this, like that, sounds like that. Whereas if they're okay, they're like, can you hear the difference? Like, so on my nails, or big difference. So I know that, aha, that now has grown too long, she needs them cutting. So immediately the vet actually noticed this before I told her. I said, yes, I've come in for the nails as well. So she did her heartbeat, she weighed her, and she said she was slightly less weight than she was last time, but she has been lower than that, so she's not worried anything about that. She had a little feel of her kidneys. She said they seemed to feel all right. She noticed that she had a full bladder, because she does drink quite a lot, so she took her out the back to do a wee sample. Now, I'm not quite sure how they do that. I don't like to ask, do you know what I mean? Because if you started asking these questions, you'd probably refuse to have anything done. So she took a wee sample, and she said her wee was a bit weak. It wasn't very concentrated, but it's on this little printout thing she had. She said it wasn't too much to be worried about. Then she looks at her little growths that she's got on her chin. And sure enough, it's not necessarily that one's got bigger, but now there are sort of two or three of them, and they're all like growing very, very slowly. She had a look in her mouth. Nothing to report there. It weren't like the growths were not growing into the mouth or anything like that. What else did she do? Then she looked in the ears, and she noted a small little black thing was starting to grow in her ear as well. Okay. And then she put her on the ground. She says, I just want to put her on the ground and see what she does. So sure enough, she went on the ground, and she starts going around. Starts walking around in circles. I said, well, that's the circle. She said, yeah, well, we'll just watch her for a while and see what happens. And eventually she came out of the circles and started wandering around the place. Then she'd stop there and start going in circles again. Then she'd walk around a bit more. She said, okay. She wasn't too worried about the work going around in circles. Interestingly, now, remember, they're vets, not me. I don't know nothing about animals. Only had to give them cuddles. And she said, because she's coming out of the circles, she's not too worried about it. If she just went round and never came out of the circles, that is a big concern of theirs. But because she eventually comes out of them, which indeed she does at home as well, you know, then she's not too worried about it. So she said, it's possible that there's something growing in her head. She said, the thing is, I could tell you to go for an MRI scan. We would do the MRI scan, say, yes, there's something in her head, but there's nothing we can do about it. She said, it's pointless. Wow. You know, and that for a vet to say that, suddenly you think to yourself, when they say something like that, you think to yourself, hello, you're not ripping me off. You know how you do sometimes? Like, I was going to that private dentist for years. You've heard me mention several times on this programme. Private dentist for years, and every time I had work done, started going to the National Health Service one, which was far, far cheaper. Far, far cheaper. And I've never had any work done there. I've been going 4 years. Never found anything to do. Private dentist, every single visit, there was a blooming fill-in that either had to be done or replaced or something like that. So I don't trust private dentists anymore after that experience. I really don't. However, once the vet says that, you know, you could have an MRI scan, it might show something up. If it does, we can't do anything about it. So what's the point? Cross that bridge when it comes to it, she said. But for now, she has, the vet has said, there doesn't seem to be anything physically wrong with her. Okay? Nothing physically wrong. But she's got dementia, and she's becoming very dependent on me. So that howling she does, as actually I thought, is basically she misses me. When I'm not in the same room as her, she misses me. Now, my cat, if you're a regular viewer, you'll know this. My cat, I restrict her to the kitchen. The reason she's restricted to the kitchen is because I did have quite bad asthma for a while. And there were a couple of things that it was suggested that I do. Number one, stop the cat coming into the house. And number two, stop drying clothes in the house. Both of which I'd done. And months down the line, the asthma vastly improved and has never come back again. So she has been in the kitchen on her own, quite warm, nice little bed in the corner, litter tray. She got a litter tray in the last year or so because she, just a minute, because she kept going on the floor. Funnily enough, I put the litter tray in it. She did use it for a long time, but more recently, she's not using the litter tray now, and she seems to just let go wherever she is. But it's not too much of a problem, to be honest. So so she's quite comfortable in that kitchen. Of course, I don't live in the kitchen. That's the thing. So I give her cuddles and things like that. She's all right for a while. And then she'll make that noise for a while. Yeah, like that. And then after a while, when I say after a while, only a couple of minutes. It doesn't go on for hours or anything like that. Eventually, she quietens down and goes back and sits. And sometimes she's also, we think, very hard of seeing now. She's also quite well blind. But the vet said, you know, you can keep her going as long as you can. You may find for yourself that the howling becomes longer and you can't handle it anymore. She said, but you will know when that time is. She says, and for now, that's the results that we've got at the moment. So Katie the cat lives to fight another day. Oh, yes. A mouse lived it. Oh, that's the wrong song, isn't it? What's the cat song where it goes after the mouse? Pussycat, what's... where are you? Oh, pussycat. How's that going now? Pussycat, da-da-da-da. I frightened a little mouse under the stair. I can't remember the words to that. So that is the news of Katie the Cat. Oh, yes. Meow. Oh, dear, dear me. So tonight, before I came up to see you, I popped over to my mate's house. He's in... he's been in Ireland for a short little trip there with his friend Wayne over there. And they've had a nice time. And I actually walk over there. Not to Ireland, dear. That is a long way. I do walk over to my mate's house. All part of the old exercise thing. It's about a 25-minute walk there and a 25-minute break. A 25-minute walk back as well. And it's all part of the exercise thing. I had a cup of tea and a few bits and pieces up there while I was there. Elaine's on the phone. We've just opened the phone lines, boys and girls. The phone number's up there. Don't call in for the moment because Elaine's on the phone right now. Hello, Elaine. How are you, darling? From Israel.
Hello, Chris. How are you?
Hello, Elaine. Not bad at all. And it's very late there, isn't it?
It's 3 o'clock in the morning.
It's 3 o'clock in the morning. Yeah. Do you know that song?
And you know what? You are the only person who would keep me up at this time.
Really? Good God.
Absolutely.
Are you on your own, Elaine, or is that a personal question, my darling? Oh, you are on your lunch. So it's not like, you know, you've got to keep me on headphones or something. Because there's been a couple of people over the years who have watched me while they're in bed with their partners and their partner is asleep snoring. And they've got headphones on and things like that, laying them in a bed. I mean, it's dreadful being in the same bed as two other people. What do people think I'm like, dear? Shocking, Elaine.
Well, I don't have that problem, so it's okay.
Oh, good. I quite like living on my own, you know. I'm sorry, I do. My sister actually said to me a while ago, I don't think you could live with anyone again. And I think she's absolutely right. Oh, have I lost you?
No,
there you are. Sorry, you went very quiet. I'm kind of waiting for something then. I don't know what.
No, well, look, I'll tell you. Remember I told you a few days ago back to my radio show?
Your radio show, yes. Your Barry Manilow radio show coming up soon, yes.
Exactly, yeah. Well, anyway, I was listening to one of the broadcasts today. Like it's a regular weekly show.
Right.
So I was listening to the station today, and the station and my co-host started promoting the special. And he started talking in English, and he went on and on, like, about this amazing special that we're doing on the 31st. And he was, like, promoting it like mad.
Excellent.
I was listening to it at work, and I had this grin on my face like you wouldn't believe. Anyway, after that, I get a message on Facebook from my co-host. And he says that the station manager is so enthusiastic about it, they've expanded the special to 2 hours.
And that's from, what, 1.5?
It was 1.5. Now they expanded it to
two hours. Oh, that's better, isn't it? It did sound to me a bit of an odd time, 1.5 hours. You kind of do it in hourly things, don't you? 1, 2, 3, 4. And one and a half sounded a bit of a strained time to me.
Anyway, so they expanded it to 2 hours, and I'm sitting there, and I'm going like, oh, my God. I mean, that's like heaven. Absolute heaven. To be able to play, like, 2 hours of Mallow music, I'm sure, like, Wendy, if she's still here.
Wendy will be there listening to you. I'm telling you now, she will absolutely be there listening to you. Wendy is very supportive of what people do. Very supportive.
Yeah, I was just like so excited. I waited until 3 o'clock in the morning, just to tell you, because you're being supportive too. So I wanted to let everyone know that on the 31st of January there will be a 2-hour Barry Manilow special.
And how do we listen?
I said I'm going to post you the link.
Okay.
So you'll be able to see it on my event page.
And what about other people who are watching my show now? How does anyone listen to that? What's the name of the station? Do they do a listen now thing on the internet type thing? Most of them do that now, I think, don't they?
You know what? When I get off the line, I'm going to...
That's all right, Don. Let me look it up for you. What's the name of the station again?
It's called Cole. That's K15OL. Nest. That's N for nothing, E, double S for sugar, and Teona, which is Z for zebra, I-O, N for nothing, and A for apple.
Okay. Oh, dear. It's all written in foreign, in little squiggles. Let me see. I don't know. I can... Oh, hang on. Translate. Let's see if that works. Translate. Oh, it has. Now, is there a list on a gate? Again thing. I can't see a listen thing on there.
There is. I have like a player there that you
can play. It does have a player, does it? Okay. I'm trying to find the player there. No, I can't see a player on there. I'm looking at colonesziona.co.il. That sounds about right, doesn't it?
I think so, yes. Yeah. It's 106 FM.
There's a green button there. I wonder what that does. Hang on. Main. Where's the listen? How do I listen? I don't know. I can't see something now. They've got a SoundCloud. Hang on. What if I type in listen now on the end of that. Let's see what happens then. No sound. Oh, 91.3 FM Jerusalem, yes? No.
No.
That's that's Coleham Musica. Coleham. I don't know. No, I think what you're going to have to do is find out what the listen thing is, and let us know there, Elaine. All right, my darling.
Absolutely, absolutely. Anyway, I just had to tell you how excited I am and how wonderful it's going to be.
I should think you are. Did you do any little preparation yet?
Oh yes, absolutely. I took your advice and I started writing down the little banter things.
Exit lines, yeah. Exit lines. That's what you want. Exit lines.
Yes, also, yeah. And it sounds, it sounds really nice.
This is excellent. All right, Elaine, darling, thank you for telling us.
Thank you. Thank you. Now I can go to bed.
Oh, no, not yet. Not until I've finished, dear. We've only got another 3 hours to do, dear. I'm sure you can stay up that long.
I have to be up in 3 hours for work.
What's that noise?
What noise?
I can hear noise then. Strange noise. Mysterious noise. Oh, hang on, I can hear it again. Oh, I know what it is. It's all right, I found it now.
Unfortunately, there are no
serious noise
in my bedroom, unfortunately.
Well, stay with us for a while, all right, Elaine? Thanks for calling, my darling.
Okay, have a good night.
Lots of love. Elaine there, calling from Israel. Looking forward to a Barry Manilow show in just a couple of weeks' time. I've got it on the Tuesday the 31st. That's at 4 o'clock UK time, I believe, all right? We do have a phone line open now, boys and girls. If anyone wants to call in, you're welcome to. I can only do one call at a time, okay? So if I'm on a call and you call in, won't be able to take it. I'll probably go to an answer phone, okay? The number is 020-8144-3477, okay? 020-8144-3477, a local London number. There's also a Skype in. If you've got Skype in, then you can use Skype. The Skype in is all one word, United Kingdom Talk. That's all one word, the Skype in United Kingdom Talk. We've also got this Facebook call-in thing. I've got to be honest, I'm not too keen on that because you never know when it... I don't seem to be able to turn off the ringing. So when when someone calls on it, it rings whether or not I want to take it. And it's all very strange and mysterious. So I need to have a little look into that one. But you could try that. We've got a call now, someone on a mobile. Hello, who's that, please?
It's Callum from Nottingham.
Hello, Callum. Callum doesn't live here. I should have your own jingle when you call in, Callum. Callum doesn't live here anymore. Now, why are you up so late? Look, 5 to 1 in the morning. How old are you?
What did you say?
How old are you?
25.
All children under the age of 35 years old should be in bed by midnight.
I've been out in town in Nottingham.
Oh, no. You're not one of these drunk people. Are you drunk?
No.
Is this an outside broadcast, Callum? You sound like you're outside somewhere.
No, I'm in the house now, so...
You're in the house or outside the house?
Inside.
Oh, okay. Where have you been out to?
Just to Nottingham Town Centre.
Was that a little singing expedition today?
Yeah. I've just gone to different bars and that for drinks.
Oh, okay. But no karaoke tonight, no?
Yeah, there was on one bar, but I went to a different bar.
Oh, okay. Did you sing many songs tonight?
Yeah.
Go on, what did you sing then?
I sang Benina, Something I Need.
Who?
Benina, Something I Need from X Factor.
Oh, where's that go then?
I can't think now.
Okay, you must have a go, dear. Something I Need. Now, what do I need? Not chocolate biscuits looking at my weight. Weight's still going up. It's still going up on my life. The only thing that I can think it can only be carbohydrates. It's got to be all this bread and stuff I'm eating. I've got to, I don't know why. And I've done it before, I've cut these things out and the weight has fallen off. But I don't seem to be able to do it this time and I don't know why that is. I want to be slim like yourself and Adam. Ah, why can't I be slim again? I don't understand it.
I never put no weight on, are they? I'm always eating.
I know. I saw that, dear, when you came down those couple of times. We had some more people come down on Monday. Did you know? We had Simon come down.
Oh, yeah.
Up Stoke way he was. He came down. He had a wonderful time. Simon. In fact, he put a little couple of notes. I haven't actually read the notes out from yesterday's show yet, which I must go on to there. When are you coming down again to have a little bit of a sing song for us all?
This month, yeah.
Is it this month?
Anytime, yeah.
Do you know what date?
No, not yet. I need to sort train tickets out.
Will you stay the night or what?
I might as well, aren't I? Cause
I was going to say, if you do, Premier Inn is a fairly good bet. I mean, I don't know how much you spend, but you must book it early. Don't leave it till the day before, because it's like 130, 140 quid then. You know, if you do it before that, you probably get it for 60 or 70. I don't know how much you usually spend on a room.
Whereabouts is this Premier Inn? Is it near?
Yes, there's two. They're both very near. Premier Inn St Pancras and Premier Inn King's Cross, I think they are. They're very close. They're both very close. Both of them are about... One's about 5 minutes away from the from Central Station, and the other one's about 10 minutes away from there.
Yeah.
So either of those will do you. And they're ever so nice, though, Premier Inns. Oh, my word. They're ever so clean. Very comfortable. They've all got boats. And they're all... Oh, you've been to one before? Oh, right, OK. Because I was having a chat with Wendy on the phone the other night, actually, about Premier Inns. And we're very, very impressed with what you get for what you pay there. It's certainly not overpriced if you book in advance. But if you leave it till the day before, you'll pay an arm and a leg for it, as Simon found out, unfortunately. All right?
Yeah.
Anything else from you today, sir?
No.
All right, Callum. Lovely to talk to you.
And you?
Don't go too far. You might miss something. You might miss something. You know that. Cheerio now.
Thanks. Yeah.
Say hello to your girlfriend for me.
I will do.
Lovely lady. Bye-bye. Bye. There we are. Callum there calling in from Nottingham. Let me just... There we are. Put that in there. So I can save people now. You see, I can save the names now. So I know who's calling. How fabulous is that, isn't it? 020-8144-3477 is the phone-in number. If you want to join us tonight, boys and girls, 020-8144-3477. Just going back to some of your messages that have been coming in during the show. Tom says you're up late, dear. Greetings. Greetings, Tom. Nice to see you, sir. How lovely to see Tom with us tonight. We've got Helen. Hello, Helen. Helen's there tonight. Simon says, do they still do karaoke at Chambers? Sorry, I didn't have time to ask him then. Dan Ellis says, the fatness around my waist is called old age spread. You could be right on that. And Simon says, I only paid 55 quid for that room at Central Station. Ah, so you might get a room at Central Station for just 55 quid, okay? Might be worth thinking about there. On to, back to the phones, and Danny Davis is on the line from Manchester. Hello, Danny.
Guten Tag.
Guten Tag. Are you speaking from a phone? Oh, I'm going to sneeze. Do you know, I've got no tissues in here. Oh, hang on a minute. Oh, no, there's an old one in the bin. Hey! Oh, dear. Oh.
Bless you.
Oh, dear me. I haven't sneezed on here for ages, have I?
No, you haven't.
I wonder what it is in here. What I need is someone to come in and dust here. The trouble is, there's so much gear to move here, Danny. There really is, Danny.
You might be allergic to me.
That's probably what it is. Why is it you're in Manchester? Oh, my ears have gone now. Just a minute. Hello, testing. Oh, one of my ears has closed up. Now, you can't win, can you? It's all going... You got this to look forward to, my friend, when you go over 50. When you go over 50, all these things start happening. It's the weight that's the... I mean, I don't mind losing everything, but I put it on weight, dear. Weight! Oh, it's so fatter and fatter I'm getting, dear. Oh, I feel sorry for the chair half the time. I look down at this chair and it's really suffering at the moment. Really suffering. Now, Danny, you're in Manchester. Have you any idea why some people call Manchester Manchesterford? What's all that about?
I don't know. I think it's just something they want to add because people like adding words to...
Have you heard that expression, Manchesterford?
I've heard of it a few times, but not much.
Isn't that strange and mysterious? And another thing, you know, are you talking to me from a phone?
Yes.
It's very, very high quality microphone. What phone are you on?
A HTC One M8.
Well, on my life, it's like you're using a microphone. It's excellent quality, your phone. Really excellent quality.
It's only a year old, so...
Is it? Well, it doesn't matter. A lot of people don't know how to use phones. You know when you're talking to them and they keep fading away and they come back, and you know they're waving the phone all over the place, aren't they?
Yep. A lot of people do it, and it really annoys me just like it annoys you.
Awful. Awful. Wendy says, is there 2 inches of dust in here? I think there is, actually. I've had to water this plant. Ray Reynolds said it was looking a bit perky, so I've watered the plant, and I've got dead leaves again. And I think this one's going to go as well. You know that. I've got enough water. In fact, there's too much water in there now. It's halfway up the...
Big Ben's off.
The little dish underneath. But look, this is dying again. Every plant that Ray buys us dies. I don't know why that is. And yet I'm quite good with my gardening and all that. Do you like a bit of gardening, Danny?
I used to, not anymore.
Why is that then?
Because I got too busy.
Busy with what, dear?
Work, dear.
What can you be busy about? Now, the thing is with you, you had a job... And I can ask you about this now. This will be of interest to a lot of people. As you know, boys and girls, I'm quite taken with caravan holidays. Last year, I went on my first caravan holiday in May, and I loved it. I love the fact that you simply get in your car with your little case, you drive to the caravan site, you collect your keys, you're in, and you are there. No mucking about, passport, security, airports, getting to the airport, getting from the airport, delays, none of that. The only delay you're going to get, and he says this, touching wood, is if your car breaks down or you hit traffic or something like that. It's the only delay. No problem. And I love it. And these little caravans, they're little houses. They really are radiators, depending on what one you want. You can have radiators in it. I go for the, you know, for the one with the radiators in every room. Some of them have got a bath in. They've got televisions, all your cooking facilities. The gas and electric is all included in the price. I love them. And I've been to two different... organizations,
parks.
Yes, parks, organizations, Haven Holidays, and is it a Home and Away? Is it Away? Oh, what's it called? Just a minute, I've got the magazine in the bathroom. Can I just go and get the magazine for a minute?
Yeah, go ahead.
And while I'm getting the magazine, if you could tell the millions of people that, how many millions are there today? I don't know, I've got a number in front of me. The millions of people here, what job that you used to do. Are you ready? Go.
I used to be a holiday park entertainer for Haven Holidays, known as a fun star. So I used to be the person that used to dance around the stage, entertaining kids, adults, call bingo.
Bingo! We love bingo! Did you have... Dabbers? Did you have dabbers?
People used to buy dabbers, yeah.
Yes, we love bingo. We had a quiz night at the place where I went with my niece. That was the one in Yorkshire, Thornwick Bay. That's quite a new place, that is. That's in Yorkshire. And they had a quiz night there and we came second. Yes, thank you very much. Of course, they came second because... Clever Uncle Chris was at the same table as them. That's why we came second. Anyway.
I was at three parks when I was with the company.
Did you say
in
several, did you say?
No, I was in three.
Oh, three. What ones were they?
Half Animal, which is in Pathelli in the Clyn Peninsula. And there's a true fact about that park. That park.
What is it like? Bodies are buried there or something like that?
No, it's one of the biggest parks that the company have got, but it has also got the biggest stage within the company.
Oh, we do like a big stage, dear.
So that was one of them.
Yes.
Then I went to Lakeland, up in the Lake District, just outside of Grangeover Sands.
I bet that's beautiful up there, isn't it?
Oh, you couldn't get a phone signal.
Oh, how long ago was that then? Blimey, that must have been years ago.
2012.
No phone signal. What, in that place with all those people staying there?
No, because it was in a little village called Fluckborough.
Right. You have to say that very carefully. That's got an L in it, has it, dear?
F-L-O-O-K.
Oh, my Lord, yes. Oh, that was close. My finger was hovering over my dump button then, dear. It was hovering, dear. Yeah, that sounds lovely. I bet that's beautiful around there, isn't it?
It's really nice, but I don't know if you've ever seen... Have you ever seen the film The Woman in Black?
No. Is that the one with that boy who's in Harry Potter?
Yeah.
Right.
If the millions of people watching have seen it...
Millions, dear, millions.
As you drive up to the house, there's like marshes either side.
Oh, it sounds very spooky. Let me just put some effect on your voice. Carry on.
So the road would have very marshy and it'd be like 3 miles long before you got to the park.
Carry on.
And then that was the second year. And then the third year I did in Port Madoc in Wales again. Because I'm
right,
obviously
yes.
Welsh, aren't I? So.
Yeah.
So
oh, sorry, just a second.
Year.
I think we've got disconnected there somehow. Are we back on there? I think we're back.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you, but we lost the live viewers for a moment, and it disconnected for some reason for a moment or two. Carry on now. I think everyone's back with us. Sorry, did you get disconnected there, live viewers? The recorded people can watch us, but not the live viewers. It dropped out then, but we're back on. Carry on, Danny. Tell us more.
So, and then obviously the third year I was in Port Madoc, and every single year was different.
Right.
There was nothing the same. The shows were completely different. You know, the characters were still the same. Like when you went to Yorkshire, I think one of your videos had, was it Bradley the Bear? Can you remember? Was it Bradley?
There was a bear.
Bradley the Bear it would have been, yeah.
I can't remember the name of it, no. But the children loved him, you know.
There was a tiger.
There was a tiger, yes.
Rory the tiger,
that's it,
Rory.
Yes, Rory the tiger. I think he was the most popular with the children, Rory the tiger, yes.
When I used to go to Haven Holidays when I was a kid, because there was only three back then, it was Rory the tiger, Anxious the elephant.
So how long ago was that then?
Well, when I first went as a kid?
Yeah.
I can't.
You sounded like Rory the Tiger purring then, if you don't mind me saying so, Diane. No, I ask you, because that surely, how long did tigers live? I think that's an imposter, Rory. That can't be the original tiger. The original tiger's probably dead by now. Has anyone told the children that one, dear?
Well, look at Mickey Mouse. He's over 50 years old.
Oh, yes, but I've been to Disney, and when you see him close up, he does look quite old now, darling.
I went to Disney I went three times, one in 1999, one in 2001, and one in 2004. And so everything is just, like, the holidays over there, they're nothing compared, you know, our holidays, sorry, over here, are nothing compared to what we've got over there.
But we still love the Haven Holidays, I love it. So you didn't like the third one that you worked at, no?
No, I didn't like Lakeland.
And why is that? Why?
Because...
Was it the people that you worked with or what?
What it was, because I was such a big park the first year I was there.
Oh.
And there was 500 plus people in the show bar each night.
Right, yeah, I see what you mean now.
And then going to maybe 150 to 200, it's kind of like a step backwards rather than a step forward.
You know... I've had a similar thing over the years where when I was DJing, you know, on the Wednesday, I would DJ at Heaven, great big London club, yeah? On the Friday, I was in a small pub in the East End and people would often come and they'd like, Chris. I said, yeah, hello. What are you doing in here? Well, I'm doing a job. Yeah, but you work at Heaven on Wednesdays. Yet so? Doesn't make any difference. Well, why? How can you work here if you work at Heaven? It's just another job.
Yeah.
And that's how you have to look at it, really. But you didn't, but did you? You couldn't kind of get in that. It's the same. How else can I explain? Okay, if you're DJing in a club and everyone's dancing,
yeah,
and then you go and do a wedding, and yeah, for the first, different. You might be booked for 4 hours, and for the first 3.5 hours, no one wants to dance. No one will get up
to drink.
And you stand there and you're DJing and you think, I must be really rubbish at this now. No, it's a different thing altogether. That a club and a wedding, two completely different things. And you have to be on the mindset that actually at a wedding, you will not have as many people dancing. That's just how it is, especially at the beginning of the night. And it's
more of a party atmosphere, yeah, isn't it, a wedding?
That's right, yeah, yeah. And if you can't get that in your head, it does you in. But I quickly got into that and realised, you know, it's completely different clubs and that. So similar thing for you, you know, going from a big place to a little place like that. You probably did it the wrong way round. If you'd have done it the other way round, you might have appreciated the really big one even more, you know. Why did you move from different places? Do you just have enough of the one you're at for a while and then...
Because when you do your season, they place you at a park, so you have to reapply for the company each year.
Oh, right, yes.
And then they send you to a park. So the first year I obviously got sent to the big park, the second year I got sent to a small park, and then the third year I got sent to, well, with the first and the third park are next door to each other.
Right.
So if they were short on one park,
yeah,
we'd go over there and vice versa.
Okay.
But the first park was just amazing. Yeah. It was lively each night. It was game shows. There was late night discos. There was party dances. Gosh. There was bingo.
Yeah, you started on the best one. That's what's happened there, isn't it?
Yeah,
and this is similar also to the people on X Factor. You know, they're on that massive, great big stage, and that's for some of them, that's their first gig. They've had no build up to go anywhere, and whatever you do, you know, say what you say about X Factor. I'm not a fan. I'm never going to be a fan of that. But at the end of the day, you're standing on a massive, great big stage, hundreds of people in front of you, thousands of people watching you on the telly. Where do you go from that? You can only go back into small places, you know. Even like if you was to do, a hall or something like that, it's never ever going to be as good as that. Whereas in old days, you would go, you know, pubs, you know, little clubs, pubs, maybe bigger places, bigger, and eventually onto the telly like that. It's gone the wrong way. And so I think the same thing happened to you. So after the third one, did you leave that before the season finished?
The season finished, then I left.
So you could have gone on to another one, could you, if you wanted to?
I would have had to reapply for a fourth year. But the thing is, when I joined the company, I think I was 21.
Right.
Yeah, I was 21. And I was there for 3 years, so it was coming up to, well, I was 21, I was there, 22, 23. I was coming up, so by the time the season finished, I was 23, so the third year.
What, is that so, old then? Is that old in that game, is it?
Yeah, it's like now I've been approached by a company in Southport, just outside of Liverpool.
Yes.
To work for them this year, and I think to myself, I've discussed it with my friends and stuff.
Is this another company, is it?
And they say, this is Harrison Holidays.
Oh, I've not heard of those. What is that, the same sort of thing, caravans and holiday parks and chalets? Right.
Mm-hmm. But all my friends said, you know, you're getting a bit too old now. I'm 28 now, I'm 29. This year coming up.
What do you think? You think that's old, do you?
Well, compared to the...
No, I know what you mean, Danny. I'm not making light of what you say, but it's the same for all of us. You know, when we've been 15 and we're, oh my God, 18 is so old. And then you get 80. Oh my God, 20 is so, oh my God, I'm going to be 20. And it just goes on forever. You know,
but the thing is, it's the energy when I was.
Oh,
when,
yes.
It's the energy when you're 18, they look for young kids about 18, don't they?
Yes. When I watch some of these people dancing on the television on X Factor or on or any of those things, you know, and they're like, you know, in boy bands and that. And I look at them and I think, oh, I'd love to have done something like that. There's no way I could move like that anymore.
No.
But, you know, I went to that when I was at that Haven Holiday. I'm watching them. And I thought, you know, I'd like to do something like that. But, you know, it soon became very obvious that there was no one remotely close to my age doing anything like that. So I think that's a bit of a non-starter. But, you know, to stand there and do singing for people and call bingo and do karaoke. Well, you know, I can do all that. But,
yeah.
But I'm the wrong age to do that now. I did think when we used to go to Pontins with my mum and dad up to about 15 years, I think 16 years old. I think I went at 16 and I was a little bastard. Oh, I did nothing but complain because I didn't want to go on holiday with my mum and dad, which you can understand that. But nevertheless, you know, I feel that particular holiday, I was so ungrateful. So ungrateful on that holiday. And even they got me a chalet and all that business, all my own. But I just didn't want to be there. You know, it's an age thing, I guess. And you can't turn the clock back and apologise for being so bloody ungrateful. But up to 15, I had a wonderful... And, you know, I should have had a wonderful time at 16. It's my own fault. I didn't have a wonderful time. Didn't want to join in. That was it. You know, but up to 15, yeah. I had a wonderful time at these Pontins holidays. And I remember being 13, 14, watching the people up there and the blue coats going around and the bands on the stage and the bloke with the microphone doing the competition. And I used to think, I want to do something like that. In a way, I do. I'm doing it now, except in clubs and not at holiday camps. Exactly the same thing, really. Except, of course, in a holiday place, you're every week a completely new crowd. Whereas where I am... Same crowd roughly every week, and now and again you kind of new ones come and go and that. So it's similar like that. But I would like to have done the holiday camp, but I think I probably left that a little bit too long that one now.
But the most satisfying thing is when my first season actually was because you obviously have to watch the character shows with the kids. You have to sit if you're not in them. Then you have to sit on the dance floor and watch them. And
that's painful, you know, that is, because I did that with my great niece and great nephew with George and Emily. And I sat there on the floor. Oh, my arse was killing me. They don't give you a cushion, do they? And it was very sad. When everyone got up, three people had to help me up.
But carry the most on, satisfying dear. Thing is... looking right, because you're obviously watching the kids, making sure they're not running to the stage and touching the characters and stuff, is actually seeing their faces smiling and then you know, laughing and getting involved and stuff. They don't know any different, but it's also quite satisfying as well when you're actually within the character to see those children's faces again, that they don't know it's you. That's quite satisfying to me, because it's like they don't know it's me. But does that make sense?
There's nothing better, is there not, than making a child happy.
That the first night I did the job, I went back to my chalet and I cried.
I know.
Because it's just making a child smile is the most best thing, and I would do it again. But I've got the interview on Monday coming up. You know, a lot of my friends go, it's up to you, but I think you're a bit too old. But, you know, it's just what...
Is that what your friend said to you? Or are you saying that to me?
Yeah. No, that's what my friend has said.
I thought you just said that to me then. I thought, bloody cheek, dear.
No, my friends have said it to me.
No,
I'm a bit too old now.
I certainly don't think 29 is too old. You will be seen, certainly by the younger members of the of the people going. Say you was to get in. Say they take you on, right? You say you was offered a job, didn't you? Didn't you say you've been offered a job?
I've been headhunted to do the job.
Right. So there you go. So these youngsters, 21, I don't know how old they go down to, probably 18. Do you have 18-year-olds doing that job? Or is that too young?
18.
So 18 up to 26. You're like the one in charge now. And I think you should take that job and step up to it. Show them what you can do. Do it. This is, you know, you're not one of the little kids now that are running. Sorry, when I say little kids, I mean one of the 20-year-olds, 22, 23, 24, running around doing their little thing. No, you've now got to show them what to do. I think you should take that job on. I think you would get great satisfaction of taking on a younger member of staff and showing them what to do. And then when they can do it, and then at the end of the season, when they are really good, and when they can do it all, you can sit that back there and say to yourself, they are doing that because of what you did. How wonderful would that be?
I know, but I'm not one for you know, going, that's my do it. I'm not one to tell those type of people to.
No, you haven't got to say anything to anyone. For yourself, in your own head, you know. If they're doing everything you've taught them, that's because of what you've done. You haven't got to tell them that, but that's in your head. And you will get enormous job satisfaction for that. I'm sure you will.
I enjoy the job doing it anyway, but it's just the whole, you know, I smoke, I drink. I don't drink every day, but maybe once, twice a week. Not even that sometimes. But as I've got older, you know, sometimes I wake up and my knees click because it's, you know, if you're dancing every single day and say my knee clicks and I can't use it, I'm going to be stuffed, really.
Well, how often does
that
happen then at 29 years old? Now, I know someone else like you who thinks themselves older. I won't say who it is, but he does internet radio. He's always, from the age of about 26, he willed himself older than he actually was. And you're doing exactly the same thing. You are willing yourself older than you are. And you mustn't do that. 29 is not old. I tell you, my favourite time in life was between 32 and 47. Not in my teens, certainly not in my 20s. It was between 32 and 47, and you're nowhere near 32 yet. You're still 3 years away from that.
Yeah.
You're willing yourself old.
Maybe I should do it.
I think you should. I think you should, and you should sound happy about it. And just get on with it, you know. What's the alternative? Stuck in a bloody office.
Yeah.
Now, you know, my cousin has a job in an office. He works in a bank. He earns an absolute fortune. The money is astonishing how much he earns.
But his job satisfaction.
Hates it. Absolutely hates his job. What would you rather do? Something where you're happy, you've got enough money to live on, maybe a little bit more, or shed loads of money and unhappy. What would you rather be?
Happy doing the job I love.
Yeah, exactly. There you go.
I know the pay's not great.
It's, I know.
Minimum wage, it's like $7.20. Yeah. And obviously it goes up in April, but yeah, $7.20. Yeah, yeah. Working 6 days a week from morning, noon till night.
Let me just read some. I've got some messages coming in. Hello to Andrew. Hello, Andrew, boys, who's 50 and he doesn't consider himself old. We got Warren. Now, Warren works on the planes. Hello, Warren. It's ages since I saw you. Hello, Warren. Nice to see you, sir. He says he loves taking on younger members and he's not, I don't think he's as old. I don't think he's 50 yet, Warren. I think he's early 40s, actually. But he enjoys showing people the ropes, you see, showing them the ropes. And you really do once they get going. You know, if I did something, let me see, I've probably done so. Oh, yes, with my nieces and nephews, you know, I've shown them certain things and given them little bits of advice. And my niece, I'm not saying that they always took my, I'm sure they probably didn't take my advice all the time, but sometimes they ask me things and I tell them. And then when you see them doing something and it's successful, you think, wow, it's not because of me, it's because of them. But, you know, anything that have helped them the tiniest little bit is great satisfaction. It really is. Really is. Wendy says, look, Wendy says, good luck with your interview. She wants you to go for it. So there we are. George Roberts is with us as well. Wendy says, we used to have the bazamataz at Pontins. I don't know what that is. The bazamataz. Have you heard of that?
That would be the kids' club.
Is it?
See, I remember at Haven. Haven, it's tigers and bears, isn't it?
I remember at Pontins we used to have an auntie and or an uncle, and they would be the people that looked after the children. That was before, and then I think we had this crocodile thing.
Yeah, I can't remember his name. I can see him now, but I can't remember his name.
The song will come back to me. Crocodile, crocodile. Da, 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 da. And it was all the little ones. By then I was a teenager, so I wasn't, you know, in that little, you know, when they're going around like in a long line and crocodile and all that business. So I seem to remember that. Yeah, the crocodile thing there.
But the one at Haven was the seaside team or something like that, wasn't it? It was the one just gone this year, gone.
Absolutely.
I've still got friends working for them. I've got friends that work for Butlins because Butlins and Haven are the same company.
Would you try Butlins then? Do they have caravans? Warren just says Steve Allen, who's on LBC. I'm sure you've heard of the great Steve Allen on LBC. I get his podcast every morning, and I have that in the car on the way to work usually. Steve Allen's in his 60s and he still lives life to the full. Now he does a proper radio show, you know, on National DAB. LBC and online as well.
Yeah.
And he's always got all these stories to tell, that he's been at the theatre or he's gone out to dinner somewhere or he's gone walking around Hyde Park or something like that. You know, you can't shut up shop at 29, Danny. You can't.
I know.
Wendy says, we used to wake everyone up bashing the pans together. I tell you what, talking about waking people up, when I was going to Pontins, they had these loudspeakers all over the place. I don't think we had them actually in the rooms, but they were like on big poles, a little bit like a German concentration camp.
Do you remember Heidi High?
Oh, it was just like that. It was just like that when we were going to Pontins. And in the morning, afternoon and evening, they would play a particular song. I can't even remember what the song was now. And as soon as you heard that song playing, it was like that was the indicator that it was time for another meal, when we'd all pour into this big eating place. And the food was really good because, of course, it was all inclusive then. Which you just paid your amount and that was it. Everything was included except drinks and things like that. I always used to have a strawberry milkshake when I was on holiday. Always at night time, I'd have a strawberry milkshake. Bless. Is that fabulous? Yeah.
But Warren, the thing is,
Warren wants to know if you're hot.
As in temperature.
Yeah, as in temperature. I have to say, you sound a bit subdued. Are you keeping your voice down for some reason?
There are other people at home, yeah.
Oh, I thought that was the case, yeah. Because you've rung up before and you're not very full of life tonight. I have to say so, darling.
You know, there's other people in the house.
I hope you're not like that when you're performing on stage at Haven Holidays this year.
I'm actually on YouTube of my first year at Haven.
Well, can you post that on my on here somewhere so we can have a look at that later?
If you want to type it in now, you can watch it if you want.
Oh, I can't while I'm chatting. That would be rude. Excuse me, I'm just going to watch the telly for 5 minutes. Steve Allen doesn't do that on LBC. You know, he isn't somewhere in a conversation and he's chat. No way. Can you just, I'll be back with you in 5 minutes. I'm just going to watch the telly. Oh, we can't do that, dear. We have to carry on. We have to carry on like mummy's brave little soldiers we do, dear.
Well, anyway, I shall bid you. Well, I shall bid you farewell off the phone, but I will be watching.
It's time to make you a promise. Time to make you a promise, Danny Davis. Here live in front of the millions of people that are watching and listening to this programme all over the world at the moment. My promise is, if you get a job in Haven Holidays this year, wherever it is, I will come on holiday to that place. I might come on my own, or I might come on with certain members, younger members of the family, like either my nephew and his family, or my niece and her family. There is my promise to you, and you must entertain us, and you must make a fuss of me in front of everyone. You know the sort of thing. Oh my God, I can't believe it. We've got a star with us tonight. Not celebrity. Please don't call me a celebrity, dear.
Celebrities, I won't call you a celebrity.
Celebrities are people like on The Only Way Is Essex. I'm a celebrity. Get me out of here. Oh, and I saw what a dreadful programme tonight I saw at my mate's house. Can I just tell you now? I wrote it down here somewhere. Because I went to my mate's house, right? And his boyfriend loves crap television. When I say crap television, I've written a list here. Look at all this preparation I do. But I don't just sit here and start talking, you know. God's sake, man. Look at this. He watches Big Brother. Big Brother's bit on the side, which he had on tonight. What a load of old rubbish. And there was some queen on there, dear. And she was shouting and screaming. And she was in that little room. She said, I want to go home now. I don't care about my pay. And I thought, oh, get real, will you? There's a woman. Well, I don't know if it's a woman. It might be a drag queen. But it looks, I don't know what her name is now. She looks like Diana Ross 25 years ago. Do you know the one I mean?
Yeah.
Who the hell is that? What does she do? I'm looking at all these people. I just about recognised that footballer's son. That's the one, Callum Best. I just recognised him. I didn't recognise anyone else on there. No one at all.
I have, to be truthfully honest with you, I have not seen who's gone in. I've read who's gone in.
No one at all. And okay, so this queen who was moaning, she eventually takes her shirt off. You know, and I thought, oh, here we go. And look, don't get me wrong, very nice to look at. But would you actually want to go out with a front date with him? I don't think so. Oh, the moaning it was doing. So they watched that. He loves the Kardashians. Yawn. You know, that home cook dining thing where a load of people go around someone's house and then slag them off. He loves all this stuff. The
Come
X Factor.
Dine with me.
What is it?
Come Dine With Me.
Come Dine With Me. That's the one. Dreadful programme. Dreadful. He loves Britain's Got Talent. But the one we had on tonight after this Big Brother, you know, of course, while that's on, I'm just sitting here on my phone. And my mate's saying, well, why are you on your phone all night if you've come round to me? Because you've got crap like that on the telly. That's why, dear. It's either flick through a few more Facebook posts that I've read 10 times already or watch that rubbish on the telly. What would you rather do?
Facebook.
Ah, Simon says, Stacey, her name is in Big Brother, singer, and argued with Whitney Houston 2 days before she died. Is that the one that looks like Diana Ross? Is it a real woman? Or is it a drag queen? What is it? Do you know, Danny?
Well, I don't know, because like I said, I haven't watched any
of
it.
It's difficult to tell, isn't it? Alan says Big Brother is the worst programme ever. Thank you. Oh, Mark's with us. Sorry, I didn't see you there, Mark. You're keeping very quiet there. Celebrity Big Brother.
I've had a thought, Chris.
Warren says, you need a man to liven you up.
I'd rather not talk about things like that. Thank you.
Anyway, well, hold on to your thought. Don't forget what you're about to say. Write it down quickly, because just before you tell me, the one that we watched after the Big Brother thing on the side. Oh, and they had that Ryland. Oh, that Ryland, dear. The one with the teeth.
Hello, welcome to Big Brother on the side. My name's Ryland.
Horse face. Oh, dear me. Fake. And they had this programme on after called Celebrity 100% Get Better or something like that. Is that the correct title? Do we know? Don't know, do you?
Don't know, no.
Celebrity 100% Better. And that's where these generally unknown celebrities, they had this woman on there. Do you know, her surname was Khan. K-H-A, and that was her surname. And, yeah, okay, she looked quite beautiful, I must say. She was very pretty. She had very big chest. Big chest where you could see something had been done to it to make it that blooming big. I mean, it was massive. and loads of makeup. And she wanted, and they went out and they asked people, what do you think on a scale of 1 to 10? And she was like getting 3 out of 10. And she couldn't understand why this was. And it's because she looked so fake. You know, you can overdo the makeup. So what they do is then do this person up and try and get them a higher score. Anyway, that wasn't the best bit of it. They had that lady, the cleaner lady, Kim. You know Kim?
Oh, yes.
Yeah. And there's another one, isn't there?
Aggie
and Kim. I think Aggie, I don't know who's the... Well, Aggie looks the older one. And Kim is like the tall one with the hair and all that. And she came on this programme. And she said, what I want to do, she says, I know I'm a granny now, and I know I'm, I can't remember how old she was. It was close to 70, but that doesn't bother us. You know, we're not worried about age or anything like that. She said, but I don't want to look 70. Can you do something with me? So, of course, they've got the old gay fashion bloke was there, of course, as always, dear. And two very young women advising her what to wear and what to do. Anyway, so it came to the adverts and then it cut back and Kim walked back. Was it Kim or Aggie?
Yeah, Kim.
Kim walked back in. Well, I'm not joking. She bloody looked like a drag queen. It was awful. It was horrendous. They put this wig on her that looked like a wig and done the makeup and the clothes. And I thought, that doesn't look like you anymore, Kim. But she, I don't know if she was lying or not, she actually said she liked it. And I'm looking at that, and me and my mate are howling at this. We are howling. She looked like a drag queen. Not like a good drag queen. Because a very good drag queen, you can't tell. You can't tell that they are a drag queen. You know, they look so good. I've worked with many, many drag queens. Some of them are amazingly looking. You would not know, except for the fact that the voice is a little bit worse. But she looked like a bad amateur drag queen. And it wasn't her fault. It was the people that dressed her who then told her that she looked fantastic. God's sake, man. Andrew says, lovely Kim looks like a bad drag queen before she's even started. Oh, dear. Now, what were you going to say before we get rid of you today, dear?
I was going to say, if I get the job.
Yes.
Why doesn't we have a United Kingdom talk holiday?
Oh, I don't think people could put up with me for that long, dear. What, days? Are you talking about days? Oh, well, I don't know about that. I mean, maybe a meal somewhere. I don't think we could have days, dear. What, where we do a couple of live shows on the stage? I'd have to clean up a bit. I'd have to do a children's show, for Lord's sake. Mind you, I can see myself dressing up as a kangaroo or something like that. Or maybe... I think I'd make a good budgerigar. I would make a good buttery guy. Yes, I could have a little beak. Well, I've got a beak already, as you can see from my nose.
But what I was saying, like, I'm saying nothing to that.
Any idea you'd be?
Like, Wendy.
Any idea which one you'd be at?
Southport.
Southport? Oh, that's in West Wales. Is that West Wales?
No, that's Liverpool.
It's Liverpool, is it? Southport's in Liverpool. Yeah. Oh, that's miles away, dear.
You can get a train direct from Euston to Liverpool.
Train, dear? I've got a lovely spaceship outside, my Toyota RAV4 hybrid, dear. Hybrid.
Well, what you could do if we had Wendy, we had Joey, we had Ray Reynolds, all that kind of crew. If you all come up, you could all jump in the spaceship.
What, in the same caravan, dear?
No, God's sharing the caravans. Man.
Oh, no, I can't be sharing a caravan with anyone, not even my own family.
No, what I mean is you'd all have your own caravan.
Well, I might want to walk around naked with the curtains open.
Yeah, but you won't. There'll be nobody in your caravan, will there?
Well, I hope not. I'm not having anyone using my toilet. I can't bear it when people use my toilet. I hate that. My mate comes round here and it's one of the first things he does. Oh, I need to use a toilet. And he runs in there and slams the door shut. and then I hear that worst noise that he ever makes in my house. The toilet seat going down so I know what's going on. Oh, no. I have to turn the telly up. I turn the telly up, and while he's in there, what I do while he's in the toilet is I get gaffer tape. I get gaffer tape and seal all around the edges of the door. And when he tries to get out, I say, I can't get out. I said, you open that door, you open the window in that toilet, and you wait in there for 10 minutes before you come back out again. And I have a switch, and I flick a switch, and fans come on in the toilet, and they blow the stench straight out that window. It's disgusting. Disgusting.
But anyway...
Danny, wonderful to talk to you today. 42 minutes, that must be the longest call ever, dear.
Yes, so I shall be going back to watch now. So night-night all, and I'll speak to you very soon, Chris.
Say goodnight to Danny. Oh, good night, Danny. We used to sing this at Pontins to the children. See you in the morning. Good night, children. I can see. I think I would make a very good Haven Holidays person, dear. Maybe I could have a facelift and go in as a 19-year-old. Would that work?
Yes, it would.
No, I don't think it would. Thank you, Danny. Have a nice evening.
Good night.
Bye-bye. There we are. Danny calling in there from Manchester, not Manchester Food. It's called Manchester. Thank you very much. Mark says bye, Danny. Thank you, Mark. Andrew says a sight for sore eyes. What, me walking around naked in my caravan? I do it here sometimes. I do. I walk around naked, dear. The cat runs a mile. She runs a mile. Simon says, I think that's a great idea. United Kingdom talk day out to Butlins. Ah, now a day out. That sounds pretty good. We could make a wonderful video, couldn't we? A United Kingdom talk day out. I like the sound of that. Warren says, Danny, enough is enough. Come on, hang up. He's gone. People are hogging the airwaves tonight. Hogging the airwaves. They certainly are. All righty. Let's have a little look there. Okay, I've got something to show you, actually. Now, you know I've been telling you. What's the time? Oh, it's 2:15. How long have I been chatting for? 1:20. God, that's a long show today, isn't it? Yes, I've got something to show you. Now, you know I've been asking you for a couple of shows now. Oh, I've got messages to read out as well, haven't I? Callum's still here as well. Good evening, Callum. Welcome back. You know, I've been asking you about these old hard drives that I've taken out of my an old computer that I've now given away to my brother-in-law because he uses the parts and things like that. I always rather give something away than chuck it out. I think there's so much business of chucking stuff out anymore all the time now. Anyway, so I've been asking you, how do I destroy a hard drive? Because obviously it's got information on there, I suppose, bank accounts and things like that. And I'm concerned that someone would get hold of it. And rather than physically destroy it, I looked around on the internet. And number one, it said, if you overwrite it with other stuff, okay, the normal person like you and me could then not get the old information off because it's been overwritten in stuff. It's unlikely that the MI5 or any government officials are going to be interested in what I've got on my hard drive. They're not interested. But, you know, I wonder sometimes when I've been doing my internet banking and stuff on that, is that information on there somewhere? You don't know, do you? We don't know, do we? We're not experts in that sort of thing. So I was going to kind of physically destroy it. But then I got to thinking, well, if I overwrite it, then generally for you and me, for normal people like you and me, you know, we're not MI5 spies or anything like, or Russian spies or anything like that, or Chinese spies, whatever. We're not spies from other places. No one's going to be interested in my stuff. Not really. So then I thought, well, why don't I just overwrite it? And then I thought, oh, well, you know, I've now taken this out of the computer, which I don't have anymore, but I don't really want to put this in my new one. So I have discovered this. I've found this on amazon.co.uk, and this is a caddy, a hard drive caddy, right? So What you do, you take the top off. It's very, very good, this. You take the top off. You have your hard drive. That's it there. Look, just a, and it's ever so light. Just a bit of plastic with some sort of socket. Can you see the socket in there? See that little socket there? Get that on the light. That's it. You can see it there. And you simply, and that's got a socket on it there. Can you see it at the front there, the socket? Is that light hitting that there? You can just about see that. There's a socket. And you simply just, Warren says, just smash an axe through it. I've tried to destroy a hard drive before like that, and it's really hard. You would be surprised. Warren, get yourself, get hold of a hard drive, Warren, and try and smash it up. Very, very difficult. Very, very difficult. Right, so you just plug that in there like that, and that's it, right? You then put that on the top. You don't have to put that on the top, I suppose, if you don't want to. So you put that back on there, hang on, I've got the back, and slide it on, closed. It gives you the two wires. So there's one there, you plug that into like a mains adapter, and you plug that into the wall, right? And there's that, it's a USB thing. You plug that into there, and then you plug that into your computer. Now, if you're lucky, it'll come up straight away as a hard drive. If not, you'll have to do something within disk management. But just type into Google, cannot see USB hard drive, and it'll tell you exactly what to do. And basically, that's it. So you go and you plug it in, and then what I did is I did a reformat first. I reformatted the hard drive, but that apparently doesn't get rid of what you've got on there. What you've got to do is overwrite it with something else. So I simply copied all my music on there because I've got gigabytes worth of music and also karaoke songs, which take up quite a lot of space. So I simply overwrote it. Is that a word? Overwrote it with music and karaoke songs. And I've not finished doing it yet. But by then, once it's overwritten, I do believe the old information has then gone. So we'll see. I don't know if anyone knows anything about that. Matt, do you know anything about that at all, Matt?
Well, what I do know, mate, you were talking about the hard drive. One thing that I've actually been told by, we'll call this an anonymous source, they've advised me to put your hard drive in the microwave.
Oh, I don't know about that.
Yeah, I don't know. It might do a bit of damage to the old microwave. But if you've got one that, you know, you're ready to throw out, just pop it in there for 30 seconds and away it goes.
Well, I'll tell you why I don't know about that. I've accidentally put in plates before with, you know, something that got a bit of decoration around the outside, possibly right. Silver or gold sort of paint stuff. And you get all these sparks flashing. And I would imagine that's dangerous. Well, I mean, the hard drive is just covered with metal, isn't it? That's the thing.
Is. That's just it, yeah.
I don't think I'd like to do that. I think you'd blow the microwave up. We'd have a fire. I'll tell you what would happen. The entire house would catch fire and the hard drive would still be sitting there completely undamaged.
Isn't that a bit of luck? Yeah.
That is absolutely what would happen. And I am 100% right in that. I do know that.
Yeah, I could see that happening. Or you could try doing that. I guess if you had a bonfire outside, right, just throw it in the old fire pit for a couple hours, see what happens.
Oh, that would probably do it. But do you think, you know, once you've overwritten it with something else, surely that's it. You can't go back after that. But as you know, as I say, I've looked on people's comments on the internet and I'm saying, come on, you know, no one's interested in this. You know, no dodgy person who's after people's bank details and all that. First of all, they've got to find it. You know, right. How are they going to find this particular hard drive in rubbish tips, in all the rubbish tips in the world? They wouldn't know where to find this. And then they've got to try and get the information. It's just not going to happen, is it?
Yeah, it's not worth their time, honestly.
No, I'm not working for the KGB or the CIA or anything like that. No one's interested, really, what's on it. I think it's just, you know, you've got that little doubt at the back of your mind, haven't you, that someone's going to do that thing. Simon Kays, who was at the karaoke last night, he said, hard drive in a microwave sounds like Honey G's new single.
Oh, that's hilarious.
Do you know anything about Honey G, do you?
Oh, I saw the performance. It was pretty funny.
I say honey. You say G. Honey.
Honey. G. Honey. G. Yeah.
Oh, God's beautiful. Sake, man. Just so, horrendous.
I
just called.
I had to give a bit of a rant tonight, and I think you're the person that might be able to calm me down. Again, I've been running into people who find it offensive that I am out and about wearing a cross necklace.
Oh, don't tell me people actually come up to you in the street and complain.
Well, here's the thing. They give me the dirtiest look. They have a look down over at my cross, look me back in the eye, and give me this sour look as if they're so offended.
We wouldn't, oh, I tell you, that wouldn't happen here. We wouldn't. No? Where are you again in Canada?
I'm in Winnipeg, right in the center of Canada.
Is there something particular about Winnipeg that is anti-Christian then or something?
Well, there's a lot of Native Americans here, so that may or may not have something to do with it.
Really?
But, yeah.
I don't know what to say to that.
I don't have any issues with people that, you know, are from India or China. They don't ever give me any problems, but these Native Americans and either other white people like myself that could be any kind of denomination, or maybe they're you know, not religious at all, and they just have a huge problem with it. But I don't understand.
It's very, very strange. Very strange. Yes. But I honestly don't think you'd have that here. That wouldn't happen here. I've got a cross thing in my car, like a rosary, hangs right, on the mirror in my car. And some people have said, oh, what's that for? And you said, oh, it's a rosary, I'm Catholic. Oh, right. And then that's the end of it. They're not, like, offended. I don't know why that's going on in Winnipeg, then. It's a shame, isn't it?
I guess I'm going to have to leave, yeah.
It's a real shame, that is. I take it you don't say anything, you just get on with it, don't you?
That's right, yeah, I just move on with it. But at the same time, you know, at the end of the day, it is one of those things. It does get in the back of my mind. And, you know, I come home and think about it once in a while. Yeah. It's terrible.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that, Matt. On another subject, how's your little boy, Jake?
Oh, Jake, he's doing very well. He is growing, like, every day. It's like he's doubling, tripling his weight. It's just amazing.
Is he walking now, is he?
Well, you know, he's already trying. He's like, he's like 7.5 weeks old and he is trying. It is amazing.
You'll have to drag him down when he climbs up those curtains.
Oh, you got that right, mate. Yeah.
My mate's cat, when it was smaller, learnt to climb up the Venetian blinds like a ladder.
Oh, no.
So don't put any of those up with a young child running about the place. They'd be climbing up those blinds quicker than you can.
Oh, a recipe for disaster, yeah.
All right, Matt. Well, good luck with that, and keep wearing that cross. Don't worry about other people, my friend.
Yeah, definitely, mate. You have yourself a good night there. Take care.
You too. Cheerio now. There we are, Matt calling in.
Bye-bye.
Matt calling in there from Winnipeg in Canada. Simon says, I worked at Butlins in Bognor Regis, 1998. Loved every minute of it. No caravans there. Not sure now. No, well, they didn't used to have caravans, did they, Butlins? It was all chalets. Pontins and Butlins were all chalets. The whole caravan thing is that the caravan... static caravan places like Haven, and they're kind of taking over now from the old holiday camps that we used to have. There's hardly any holiday camps now. I remember the Pontins holiday brochure, and it was, you know, so thick, and there were parks all over the country. Now there's only about 4 or 5. It's a bit sad how that's gone, but that's people. A lot of people go abroad now. I mean, I went abroad for years and years, and I enjoyed it, but I hated the journey going there and back. I really, really, and I went in the posh seats in the plane in the business class. I'd saved up and gone like that, but I still absolutely hated it, getting to the airport and all that business there. Okie doke. Let's have a look then. I think we're going to do today's birthdays now, boys and girls. Oh, Dan says, have you broke your live feed? Yeah, there was a little problem with that. That sometimes happens. It disconnects somehow. But it's all back there. Mark says, Heidi hi. Absolutely. Heidi hi. Heidi ho. Heidi hi. Heidi ho. Let's do today's birthdays, boys and girls. It's Wednesday the 11th. We're due today's birthdays. Don't forget, by the way, I'm hosting quiz night tonight. It's quiz night tonight at the King's Head Theatre Bar. Every Wednesday night starts at 8:30, finishes at 10:30. Okay, 2 rounds of questions, a picture round and a music round. I can't remember. Oh, yes, the music round today is London Symphony Orchestra. So what I've got is 10 little bits of music as played by the London Symphony Orchestra. You simply have to name the tune. So that's the music round tonight. There you are. So if you're coming down, you might have a little bit of a get one over on the other teams by knowing that first. All right, so that's every Wednesday night, starting again tonight. Quiz night at the King's Head Theatre Bar in Upper Street, Islington, 8:30 to 10:30. Get there about 8 o'clock if you want a table. Even better than that, book a table by phone. Ring in advance, OK? There was a message I wanted to read out here from Joanna. Hello, Joanna. Who leaves a message on the Bluetooth page. Excuse me a minute. And she says, what do you do on your quiz show? Well, that's it. I read two lots of questions. I read a picture round and a music round, but it's not online. That's in a venue, OK? So it's a quiz night that I do, OK, my darling? Will you please tell me what a skip is? OK, a skip is a thing that you or builders can hire, and it gets put outside your house or wherever close by, and you put all your rubbish in it, and then a big lorry comes and takes it away. You've probably got a name for it yourself. So that's what a skip is. Big rubbish. It's like a massive big rubbish bin. You put everything in there, beds, furniture, old televisions. Big lorry comes and takes it away, takes all your rubbish away. So it's a thing for rubbish. All right, my love. All right, today's birthdays then. Happy birthday to Sarita, who recently joined the show just a little while ago. Happy birthday, Sarita. 33 years old today, darling. Happy birthday. Happy birthday today to Alex Douglas, superstar barman at Central Station, who's 19 today. So young. So young. Happy birthday, Alex. Happy birthday to the lovely David Edward Ratcliffe, who joins the 40 club today, the over 40s. Hello, David. You don't look 40, love. The same as I don't look 40 either, I know. Happy birthday today to Stephen Meyrick, to Teon Blake, who's 33 today, and to Louise Otter, who's 44 today. Here comes the song. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Sarita, Alex, David, Stephen, Teon and Louise. Happy birthday to you. So we've just worked that out. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I think 6 names is the maximum I can get in that little gap that I've got to read the names out for the birthday. So have a nice birthday, everyone. Thanks for joining us tonight, boys and girls. It's always an absolute pleasure to do a live show for you. They're not scheduled at all. I just do them kind of as and when. Although now I have some more nights off from work. I do hope to do some more of these. And I also appreciate, I never ask you to, but I know a lot of people have started cutting and pasting the recordings of the show on their wall as well. And that is appreciated. And I never ask you to do that. I always think it's, I don't know, I've got a little thing about that, thinking that, you know, you shouldn't ask people to do things about that. But if you do, thank you very much. Now, if you were wanting to watch the recording of this show now, you will have to wait a while. It doesn't reappear as soon as on the wall. The live show disappears and there's like no trace on it, and then the recording version of it, which is exactly the same as this but probably in a little bit better quality, that goes up a little bit later on. It does take quite some time to get up there. All right, thanks so much for watching and listening, boys and girls. Enjoy your Wednesday. Cheerio now.